We're going to start this section by talking just about bar graphs. To do that, we need a few definitions. First, a data set is simply a collection of data values. That might be heights, weights, gender, anything that we can collect on an object or person. A frequency table is a list of how often each data value occurs in the data set. Let's say, for example, we're looking at a second grade class and we're going to record gender. So there would be a line for girls, a line for boys, and it would say how many of each were in the class. Relative frequency would then say what percentage of the overall class is girls versus boys.
The first method we're going to use to display data is a bar graph, and this is again exactly what it sounds like. It's a display of bars in a graph that represent the data. Most often, bar graphs have the data values listed across the bottom horizontally. So these are the data values. And then vertically in the graph, we would have the frequency, or perhaps the relative frequency, depending on what we wanted. And it's still the idea of like an XY graph, except it doesn't have to be graph in the regular algebra sense of the word. Each of these data values will have a bar associated with it. Generally, the bars are separated by spaces. We will have one bar for each value, and the height of the bar will be the frequency of that data value or relative frequency. We can do this for numerical data or categorical, so you could choose your favorite TV show or what night of the week you like to go out to dinner or whatever. Those could be categorical along the bottom edge instead of, say, how many times do you go out to dinner or something like that, which would be numerical. So the first example, we're going to look at this bar graph. So again, notice that the bars are separated by a little bit of space here, that there's one bar representing each of the data values, 7, 8, and 9. And the height is going to represent the number of students who are that particular age. So I have a couple of questions about this. Let's start with how many students were in the survey. How many total students? How are we going to find that? Well, we can see all of the data values, 7, 8, and 9, in each of their frequencies. So let's see. There were 3 7-year-olds, 1 8-year-old, and it appears to be 5 9-year-olds. It's hard to tell. That's not really lined up well, but that's what it looks like. So total, there are 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 students. And then we can ask questions like, how many 9-year-olds? Or something like that. So just talking about reading, and there are 5 9-year-olds. 9 students total, 5 of them are age 9. So the bar graph can give us a lot of information in a quick amount of time. It also gives us a visual. Immediately I can see that 9 is the most common age in this group, followed by 7 and then 8. So it just gives me a lot of information quickly. In our second example, we're going to look at data that's categorical. So instead of having a numerical value, I have a categorical value. So I have a value of red, blue, green, black, or pink, the favorite color, and we have some students reporting this. How many students were in this survey? How many? Well, let's see. It's hard to tell this time, isn't it? Because the bars aren't nearly as clear. So we're just going to estimate off of this. And this is one of the issues we could have in a bar graph, is we might not be able to be very specific. So this looks to be maybe 5 here. This looks to be about 10, 15. This is probably, I don't know, 23. This looks to maybe be 2. So we could add all those up. So I have 25, 30, 40, 55 students. What was the most common favorite color? Well, the most common is the one that had the most number of students, so that's going to be red. Okay, our last example is new residential construction in the U.S., I'm assuming, in August and September of 2001, September of 2000. These are data reported by the U.S. Census Bureau that I got offline. And I didn't create this graph, I got it online. But this is what's called a pictogram. because instead of the bars being just plain old bars, they're pictures instead. So it can be very visually appealing, but there you have do have to be careful because we have to represent data accurately. And so you can see how instead of having a partial house up here, they opted to put the partial houses on the bottom so that the tops are a little bit more clear. And you also have to remember height versus, you know, are we going to make the houses bigger if it represents more? Are we going to make it taller, etc.? And be careful about what that visual represents. So I wanted to point those couple things out in this example. And we can read from it from there. So if I want to know how many houses, how many building permits were issued in September of 2001, I'm going to estimate it off of the top of this graph and go over from there. So somewhere probably around 1.6 million or so, or I mean 1.535 or so. Now you want to be really careful with a bar graph, both when creating them and when reading them, because there are some pretty common issues that can deal with how we visually see the data coming on the bar graph. Some are intentional, sometimes they're not. One of the things is that we could have scale differences. And scale differences aren't necessarily a problem, but they can make something appear more pronounced than it is. We could have a scale that's shrunk. So it's actually called truncating. So we could truncate one of the axes and make the differences appear more pronounced again. The size of the picture is really important. So if I want to represent double, so if I have a little house and I want to represent one that's double the height, so it's going to be up here. Well, I want to actually to represent it fairly, I should represent two houses of that size rather than representing this house, which is actually way more than double. So the height is double, but the area is way bigger. So this is what you want to avoid. Instead, you want to make a second house on top of the first, so that each house represents the same amount, for example. The last is not including data values of zero, not including a frequency, rather, I mean, a frequency of zero. So when we have a data value that gives us zero, this is particularly important in numerical data because it might not show us the correct spread of the data. So could we have seen these in any of the possible and in the other previous bar graphs that I showed you? Well, check out the pictogram. Look at where the pictogram starts on the y-axis. The pictogram starts at 1,400,000. Now, it does make sense. I don't want to make this graph go all the way down to zero when these bars are so high. However, I also want to point out how it makes it look different. Because, for example, in here I have four houses tall versus seven. And four to seven, well, I mean, that's just a little more than half, right? But that's not even close to true. This is about 1,500,000 and, I don't know, 20,000 maybe. And this is just over 1.6 million. So maybe even. So it's nowhere near being double the number of housing completions between those 2 months. So it's really important that when you're reading the graph that you understand that difference. It looks very pronounced here, but in actuality, when you see the numbers, you wouldn't even find that to be that different. But they did do a good job of making all the houses the same size. I like the fact that they used these partial houses on the bottom so that it's still representative of the correct height, but you have whole houses on top. Makes it a little more appealing. I think the other graphs were pretty good, but this is just one example of how the scale or the truncation of the scale can really have an effect on visually how you might just perceive this. And that's the end of this section.